And God is here to supply that need in your life. Amen. Once again, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Habakkuk 2 and 20.
True. With thanksgiving, I'll be. Right now, prepare for our announcements. Amen.
Spring is in the air. Let's find out what's going on at Mount Moriah Community Church. Welcome, first-time visitors and special guests. Please introduce yourself in the chat box during our service. We invite you to join us for after-service fellowship.
Stop sharing, First Lady.
Did I click something? I must have. Let me go.
No, I think it's just coming from here. I can do it on my end.
You got it? Second.
Yes, ma'am.
All righty, hon.
That's not where I meant for it to go. I'm sorry, everyone.
That's all right. It's all good.
Mute yourselves, please.
Want me to close my screen? You want me to start it over, Danielle, on my end?
Can you not hear it?
I can't hear it. Yeah, I don't think anybody can hear it.
I don't know. All right, you want to try?
Yeah, let me give it another go.
All right.
Here we go. All right, let me go. Let me see if I can go here. Let me start back here. Okay.
He is risen. Join Mount Moriah Community Church for one of our exciting services in honor of Resurrection Sunday. Palm Sunday, March 28th. Seven Last Words, Friday, April 2nd. And Resurrection Sunday, April 4th. Hope to see you there. Invite your friends and family. Join us for one of our upcoming church shut-ins. Our dates are April 21st to the 23rd, July 21st to the 23rd, and October 20th to the 22nd. Don't miss this opportunity to fast and pray for our congregation and for others. It's our Zoomiversary, a year in Zoom. March 7th, surveys will go out so that we can get your feedback about your Zoom experience. Want to know more information? Contact First Lady Sheka or Dr. Danny after service. Join us every Wednesday at 7 p.m. on Zoom. Register with First Lady Shepherd. Have a birthday coming up? Submit your birthday in the chat box so we can celebrate the birthday blessing you are. Happy birthday! Service again. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, Mount Moriah Community Church, today. It's a blessing to have a pastor who cares. Pastor John P. Shekka Jr. is only a phone call away. So schedule a time to chat with him today at 631-617-1362. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Luke 6:38. There's several ways you can give: online, through Zelle, or Givelify. And you can mail in your payment. But don't forget, make checks payable to Mount Moriah Community Church. During the service, please click on the link for more instructions. In need of technical support during service? Not to worry, contact me, Dr. D. Either leave a message in the chat box or send a text to 678-431-6740. Want to learn more about our announcements? Email us at mtmcc7. Thank you for listening to our announcements. Now, enjoy the rest of the service.
Amen. I was enjoying those announcements. Thank you, Dr. D, for those announcements. And right now, I just would like to acknowledge, yes, we would like to, oh my, starting all over
spring
again.
Is in the air.
Well, let's well, well.
Going on.
Okay, I'm going to stop sharing. Oh, what an interesting morning. That's all right. God is good. Anyhow, I'm going to stop sharing. And while I'm looking at all the faces this morning, I'm going to acknowledge all of our March birthdays. Starting off with Rochelle Burr. This is the sister as well as the daughter of Elder Roy and Erling Stewart. Her birthday was on March the 3rd. We have our John Sheckett, Elder Sheckett's grandson. His birthday is actually today. So wherever you are, John, if you're on the Zoom, God bless you. Happy birthday, John. Next, tomorrow on the 8th, our own Letitia Jackson, that's her birthday, God bless you. And her daughter, Somalia Jackson, was born on the 12th of March, amen. We have our Patricia Chisholm, that's the sister of Cynthia and Gail. Her birthday is on the 14th, amen. And my own sister, Lady Faye Gardenhire, her birthday is actually on the 21st. And we can't forget Mother Gardenhire's birthday, which is on the 18th of March as well. A lot of March birthdays. Lastly, our brother Mel Pickney, that is the husband of Gail Pickney. His birthday is the 30th of March. So God bless to all our March birthdays. I think I missed a birthday. Sister Moore, Pam, correct me. Is mom's birthday this month too, right? The 23rd, 26th? If I am
the 27th. The 27th.
Oh, okay. Thank you. How can I forget? Sister Moore, forgive me. Yes, March 27th is Sister Moore's birthday. God bless you, Mother Moore, and all our March birthdays. I tell you, this Zoom is wonderful because we've added a lot more birthdays each and every month. Our family is growing, and we're grateful for that. So please forgive me if I overlooked your birthday. You need to put it in the chat box. Next month, we'll be here before you know it, April. And so we're looking forward to celebrate with you as well. But God bless to all our March birthdays this morning. God bless. I'm going to go back to share so we can have our Elder Roy Stewart read our scripture. Hold on for a second, church. Amen. Amen. I would like to make one other announcement. Please forgive me. Oh my goodness, this is it's not letting me out of there. Let me see something here.
Click on the scripture.
Yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and click on the scripture, y'all. Here we go. Yes. Amen. Right now, we're going to have our scripture reading by our own Elder Roy Stewart. Good morning, Elder Stewart.
Morning, Sister Jackie and Mount Moriah Church. I'll be reading from the King James Version. I'll be reading from the book of James, the third chapter, verses 13 through 18. Who is a wise man and endure with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. But if ye have bitter envy and strife in your hearts, glory not and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envy and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace of them that make peace. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Elder Stewart, for reading God's word to us this morning. Let us meditate on it daily. Amen. God bless you. Right now, we're going to have our Elder Rhonda Sheckett lead us off in prayer this morning. God bless you, sis.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for this first Sunday in March. Oh, how the time is just rolling on so fast. We thank you, oh, Father God, that again, 24/7, we are never alone. You are always with us. Oh, Father God, we thank you again for Mount Moriah, for the whole Zoom family. Lord, we thank you for the prayer list. We thank you for salvation so rich and so free. Yes. We thank you for the power and mercy of Almighty God, forgiveness of sins, the shed blood of Jesus. Yes. We thank you, oh, Father God. And Lord, continue now to tell it a message today for every listening ear. You know what each one of us stands in need of, Heavenly Father. We're made, created in your image and in your likeness and beyond the shadow of the doubt. You love us. because you made that provision for us, oh Father God, to be reconciled back to you through your Son. Continue now to bless this service in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Elder Rhonda, for that prayer. Amen.
You're welcome, Jesus. Sis.
God bless you. God bless you.
And you too.
Right now, we're about to participate, or everyone can participate, in our testimonies and scripture reading, as well as songs. Let's give God the glory this morning. He truly is worthy of our praise. I would just like to start off with a scripture. I'll be coming from Psalms 29 and just one verse. It says, the Lord will give strength unto his people, and the Lord will bless his people with peace. I thank God for that scripture, and I thank God for his strength that he gives me each and every day. And I thank him for his peace, learning each and every day as well to walk in his peace and to trust him when things arise, and to realize that God has everything under control, makes no mistakes. He just wants us to trust him. You know, sometimes it's easier said than done, but I guarantee you, each and every day as you walk this journey with him, it gets better with the trust. God is faithful, definitely. He's proven himself each and every time. And I thank him for that. I thank him for each and every one of you praying for me. I definitely do feel your prayers, and I thank you for them. And I thank God for my family. Truly, it is a blessing to be here this morning and to see all the lovely faces. And just continue to pray for me, as I definitely pray for you. And everyone, be encouraged. Be encouraged. We're not in this by ourselves. So to God be the glory. Amen. Amen. I'm going to call on our brother and sister, Chloe and Austin, this morning. Good morning.
Hebrews 4:14-16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the being of our
infirmities.
But was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin.
Amen.
Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find ways to help in time of need.
Amen. Timely scripture, Chloe. Awesome. Again, God's word is awesome. From Genesis to Revelation. God bless you, hon. Brother Austin.
Psalm 76:1-3. In Judah is God known. His name is great in Israel. In Salem also is his tabernacle, and his dwelling place in Zion. There break he the arrows of the bow, the shield, and the sword, and the battle, Selah.
Amen. God bless you guys. Love you this morning, always. God bless you. Amen. Amen. I'm going to call on our sister Whitley. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
God bless everyone today.
Yes, amen.
As I was reading through my Bible, I came across an instruction from God in Psalms 29, verses 1 and 2. It says, give unto the Lord, O you mighty ones. Give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. And as I try to walk each day in holiness, I am more thankful than ever for all that he has done, what he is doing, and what he will do for us as a family in the future.
Yes.
And God, thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for sharing that, Sister Whitley. Sometimes we just need some words of encouragement. And the best place to find that is in God's word. Amen. Amen. God bless you this morning. Sister Moore, can I call on you this morning?
Yes. Okay. I am reading Psalms.
Isla, what you doing over there?
I'm reading Psalms. I got to find my verse now. Okay, 23rd verse.
Is, amen.
Am I right?
Yeah. You mean the chapter 23, right?
No, chapter. Oh, yeah, I have to get to chapter 34. Chapter 34, okay. A little, 34:16. A little that a righteous man have. I can't see that. That righteous man have is better than the riches of many wicked. For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholdeth the righteous. The Lord knows the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time, and in the days of famine they shall be satisfied. But the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord shall be as the fat of lambs.
Amen.
They shall consume into smoke, shall they consume away. The wicked borroweth. And y'all watch out, the wicked borroweth and payeth not again, but the righteous showeth mercy and giveth. For such as be blessed of him shall inherit the earth, and they that be cursed of him shall be cut off.
Amen.
Amen. That's I could keep going.
Mother Moore, where were you coming from again?
Oh, come from Psalms 37. Yeah, I don't know myself, Jackson.
Yeah, it looked like it's Psalms 37, Jackie.
Yes, okay, got 37 starting at the 16th verse.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, yeah.
God bless you, Sister Moore. And love you and happy pre-birthday. I know we're a little early. God bless you. Thank you, Pam, for helping Mom. Good morning, good morning. Sister Blunt, I see you smiling. God bless you this morning.
Praise God, he caught me off guard.
Yeah.
This is nothing but Jesus. First, giving honor to God, which is the head of my life, to Pastor John, the First Lady, Sister Jackie, to all the mothers of Zion and Mount Moriah, to the family and the children of Mount Moriah, and to the world. Oh, glory to God. Give me grace to sing this song. I've been practicing, God. I'm not a singer, but you can sing along with me in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Give me more grace, Father.
That is good. That's all right, hon.
Okay. I really love the Lord.
Yes.
I really love the Lord. You don't know what he done for me.
Yes.
He gave me the victory. Yes, I love him. I love him. I really love the Lord. I really love the Lord. I really love the Lord. Saint, you don't know what he done for me. He gave me the victory over my enemies and death. I love him. I love him. I really love the Lord. I really love the Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes.
I really love the Lord. You don't know what he done for me. He gave me the victory. Yes, I love him. I love him. I really love the Lord. Whew. Thank you in Jesus' name. Love you, saints.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, that's all right, Sister Blunt. God bless you this morning. Hallelujah. That's all right. That's all right. God bless you, hon. Praying for Brother Anthony and the whole family as well.
God bless you. Love you all, saints. I thank you. I feel your prayers in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus.
God bless you. Love you, saints.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Sister Wendy? She might be at work, so...
I'm here. Good morning, everybody.
I'm catching people off guard this morning. It's not me.
I just want to say God bless everybody, and I'm happy to be among you.
All right, now. Just had to hear your voice. That's all. God bless you.
Thank you.
You had a good week. God bless you.
Yeah, excellent. All the time. God is good.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Sister Smith, good morning.
Good morning, Mount Moriah. I love you all. And I'm reading from the 27th Psalm. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fail. The wall shall rise up against me, and this I'll be confident. There's one thing I desire of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. That's the fourth verse from the 27th Psalm. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. Oh, I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Oh, when I rose this morning, I didn't have no doubt. I know that the Lord will work it out. Oh, I fell down on my knees. I said, Lord, help me, please. And I got up shouting the victory. Thank God for
playing
that song on my heart. And Lady Shepherd, I don't know, to ask a pastor to self-prayer for my family. I didn't go to see Booker, but I saw him on the telephone. And he said he was doing good, but he got to have one more surgery. Now, I don't know what that one is, but y'all pray that whatever he have, that he will come through victoriously.
Amen.
All right.
Amen. Yes, we will continue to pray for the whole family, but especially for Booker this morning. Amen. I'm going to mute you, okay, Sister? Okay, thank you there. God bless you. Amen. Brother Ralph, you have some words this morning? You have to unmute yourself, Brother Ralph. Brother Ralph, I'll come back to you. All right. I'll come right back to you. If you see the little microphone, I don't know what you have. That's what you need to click on. I'll be back to you, Brother Ralph. Hold on. Sister Cynthia, I see you're unmuted. Good morning. Yes,
I see you pay attention to everything.
I'm trying.
First of all, I want to give honor to you, First Lady, because God says give honor where honor is due because you watch for our souls.
Oh, God bless
I
you.
I also want to let you know you look very stunning in your pearls. Okay.
Thank you.
My scripture for today is Hebrews 11:1, where it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And my testimony is also what you mentioned today, thanking God for peace, because yes, when things come upon you suddenly, I kept peace. I didn't get anxious or worried. But my testimony is I'm believing God that my son-in-law is going to get the job that he wants, which is not far from here, so that we won't have to move to another state or city or town.
Amen.
And I believe God that he opens doors that no man can close. So I told God, any way you fix it, Lord, will be all right with me. I'm trusting in Jesus, and I'm giving him the praise now.
All right, now.
I'm thanking him for the praise. That's my testimony. I'm thanking him ahead of time. Say, don't wait until the battle's over. Shout now.
Amen.
I'm shouting now.
That's all also, right.
I'm thanking God and praising God for the word and helping us to realize that we must have love one for another. And I'm praying for those that don't realize that the enemy has given them a spirit of error and they don't realize that you can't say you love God and hate your brethren.
That's true.
Or your sister. So I'm believing God that God will mend all wounds, help people to learn how to forgive one another.
Yeah.
Because most of all, it's the Christians sometimes don't realize, you know, but I'm thanking God because I know it's going to happen and I'm putting that person's name on the altar and I'm believing God for their deliverance and God will break the yoke.
That's all right. I like that now.
Amen. Amen. That's it for me. Let me unmute myself.
That's all right. It's all good. Nothing wrong with that. That's what testimony service is all about. God bless you, Cynthia, always, always. My dear Brother Ralph. There you go.
All right.
All right now.
I want to say good morning to Mount Moriah, and I want to give God the honor keeping me and keeping me safe from one week to the other week and everything. And sometime I think about the neighborhood here that, you know, we were all one big family because it was a new development. And it seemed as if it's only three of us left, the originals. And I'm the only one without this Alzheimer's and stuff. So I thank God for that. So can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. The other day I was putting the garbage out. And so somebody came by, I guess, I don't know who he was. But anyway, he says, "That you, Ralph?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "You still here, man?" I said, so I said, "Yeah." I said, with the help of God, I says, "I'm still here." I said, "Boy, oh boy." He says, you hanging in there?" I said, "No, I'm not hanging in there." So it reminded me, I was in the mall, and so I met one of my coworkers, and so I hadn't seen him since we retired. So I asked him, I says, "How you doing?" He says, "I'm above ground." And I didn't get it at first, you know. He says, "God is keeping me here." I said, "Well, God is keeping me too." We shook hands and went on our merry way. It just show you how God is, you know. And I give him praise every day, every day, every night as I walk through this house here. What else can you say? But thank God. Because at my age, how many of us left, you know? I have nobody, no friends or nothing. You know, I have family, but I have all my friends and co-workers, they're all gone. So I thank God for that. I thank God for that. And I thank him for keeping me and keeping me in my right mind and everything, because that to me is very important. If you lose that mind, you're in trouble. So I want everybody to continue on to pray for me and to keep me, you know, and I thank you for that. Thank you.
Oh, yes.
And one other thing, my son's birthday is March the 13th, too.
Okay. I'm going to add him to the list.
Gregory Davis.
I got him. Thank you so much, Brother Davis. I always enjoy hearing from you. I enjoy my seasoned saints. They're such an inspiration to me. God bless everyone over 85. All right, the other ones are young. 85 and below, y'all still young. God bless you. Love you all. Love you all. Love you all. Sister Deaconess Brewer, did you have your finger up in the air there? Did you want to say something this morning? Feel free. You need to unmute yourself. Okay, now. All right.
Your faces. Glad to be at the number one more time. As I went to, you know, take the shot, you know. And everybody, when I got home, they was calling me, you know. And even yesterday, they said, "You still here?" I said, "I'm still here in the name of Jesus. He wants to keep me here. Hallelujah." I didn't know if they that so, you know, I said, I guess they figure, you know, if I take that shot, you know, I wouldn't be here or something other. They said, I will, for you to go get the shot first. And when you feel all right, then I go take the shot. You might wait, and when you take the shot, you might not even get the good food. But, you know, I took mine in the name of Jesus. And I had in mind that everything going to be all right, because in my Father's hand, in his hand, hallelujah, he'll hold you up. Hallelujah. Things might not go right all the time, but he'll come in and make everything. I'm just so glad and happy. You know, oh, joy. Hallelujah. That's all joy for what they call me and tell me is all right. I said, why not? I shouldn't be all right. Hallelujah. I'm in the hand of God. You know, if you're in the hand of God, you just depend on God, put in God's hand. You know, if you die, you're hallelujah. You in Christ. You know, I got something to look forward to see his face. You know, but hallelujah. Anyhow, you know, I just convey to her. You know, if you get Christ in your life and accept him for your personal sin, you don't have anything to worry about. Cause you working toward to go home. You know, to see Jesus. And I thank the Lord. I'm so happy and so glad for my family. You know. They are praying, hallelujah, sometimes, you know, seem like they don't like you, everything going on, but thank God, I'm still holding on, I still got Jesus in my life, hallelujah, and thank God, and tell Jesus, hallelujah, tell him to Jesus, he is able to, hallelujah, to take away the pain, hallelujah, but if you live right, hallelujah, it ain't gonna be there all night, because it gonna vanish away. Hallelujah. Thank the Lord today for Pastor. Thank you, Lord, for today. Thank you, Lord, for all y'all that I see now. Hallelujah. I may not be here tomorrow. Hallelujah. But I say I can see Jesus in my life. I thank the Lord for holding on. Thank you for the grand. Hallelujah. Thank the Lord. You know, they started the school and the distraction came. pain. Hallelujah. Don't seem like they couldn't get another start back in, you know, back in school. But I thank the Lord. Lord knows. Hallelujah. What they need is you. Hallelujah. To continue to depend on him. Hallelujah. Not on grandma, not on great grandma, but on Jesus. Hallelujah. We spend. Let's continue to pray my strength in the Lord. I would like to take the 150th song. Hallelujah. To praise ye the Lord. Praise God in all the sanctuary. Praise him in the heart feminine of the power, and praise him, for he is mighty and act. And praise him according to exceeding joy. Hallelujah. That's my song. Hallelujah. Praise him. Hallelujah. When the song goes down, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for he is real. And he always gonna be God. So glad. Hallelujah. Nobody can't take things from him. Hallelujah. They can try, but hallelujah. No way, no how. Hallelujah. Thank God I can think it in my mind. You say what you want. Hallelujah. But God, hallelujah. He a God all by himself. Hallelujah. He ain't take nothing from you, and he won't see nothing from God. Receive him as he is. Pray my strength in the Lord.
Unmute yourself, First Lady.
Good morning, Sister Davis. Oh, I'll get back to her. God bless. Oh, go ahead, Mother Jackson. Good morning to you.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, all. Giving honor to Pastor Sheckett, First Lady Jacket, to the elders, to all the saints and the children of Mount Moriah. So thankful to be in your presence one more time. Just want to say it's a blessing and just thank God for his continued mercy and grace that he bestows upon us, that this provision that he has made for us to gather like this, to see each other and encourage each other. It is such a blessing. And we thank him so very, very much for it. I would like to share this praise report. I had mentioned the little 9-month-old, well, she's older now, in our family, who had open heart surgery. She had it when she was 9 months old. Then after that, she had COVID. Just like the report, she's fine on the floor. She has a little twin brother, and she's taking everything from him. She's doing fine. So it's a wonderful praise report about the awesomeness of God's power and what he can do and continue to do in our lives. I would like to share the first three verses of Psalm 67. God be merciful unto us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us, that thy way may be known upon earth, thy saving help among all nations. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee.
Amen.
So we just praise your name, dear Lord, because you're so worthy of our praise.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. That's all right. God's word, you can read it, I tell you. Oh my goodness. God's word is so true. It's just so true. It's just so rich and full. And oh, I tell you, it's just peace to your heart and soul. God bless you, Mother Jackson, for that. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing. Anyone else this morning before we move on? Hallelujah. Yes. Amen, Sister Letitia. That's right. Food to the soul. Let me tell you, the bread of life. God is awesome. Anyone else this morning before we move on? Go right ahead, Sister Carolyn. Good morning.
Good morning. I have a song.
All right. Uh-oh.
And I wanted to sing a song like towards when Pastor is getting ready to preach. I know we need to have a song, but I kind of, what shall I render?
Uh-oh. That's his favorite.
Hey, amen. Let me get my glasses.
What shall I render unto God for all his mercy?
Oh, yes.
What shall I render? Tell me what shall I give?
Oh, yes.
God has everything, and everything belongs to him. God has everything, and everything belongs to him. What shall I render? Tell me, what shall I give?
Yes.
All I can render is my body and soul. That all I can render, that is all I can give. Because God has everything, and everything belongs to him. God has everything, and everything belongs to him. What shall I render unto God for all his mercy? What shall I render? Tell me, what shall I give?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. To God be the glory.
To God be the glory. What a wonderful song to end our praise and testimony and scripture reading part of the service. God bless you, Sister Carolyn, for that. And again, right now, we are going to turn this part of the service over to our Pastor John, but I'm going to play a song first before sermon. Amen.
Always look at me and think that I'm going to have a little salad, maybe a soup, and that'll be the whole meal. And when I do my actual order, there's this priceless look on their face like they can't believe.
One second, Saints.
Supposed to have it all together, and when they ask how you doing, just smile and tell them never better. Lie number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours, so keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. Truth be told, the truth is rarely told.
I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. You know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth.
Can't hear it, Jackie.
There's a sign on the door, says come as you are, but I doubt it. Cause if we live like that was true, every Sunday morning pew would be crowded. Didn't you say church should look more like a hospital? A safe place for the sick, the sinner and the scarred and the prodigal.
I'm gonna stop the music. You can't hear it, Pastor John.
No, I wasn't able to hear it.
Can you hear it now?
No.
I'm not playing it now. That's you can hear me though, right?
We can't hear you now, Pastor. But
yeah, I can hear you clear, Danielle, Dr. D.
Okay, you can't hear the music.
I could hear it.
Okay, I'm going to continue, okay, Pastor?
So the bus can,
yeah, go ahead.
A little low?
It's low, but we can't hear it.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
Like me, well, truth be told, the truth is rarely told. Oh, am I the only one who says I'm fine? Yeah, I'm fine. Oh, I'm fine. Hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know. So hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. Can I really stand here unashamed, knowing that your love for me won't change? Oh God, if that's really true, then let the truth be told. I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, but being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. Yeah, I know. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told.
Amen. We'd like to thank God for that song bringing us into our lesson this morning. But before we begin, I'd like to offer up a prayer for the service, for the sermon, I should say. Precious Lord God Almighty, holy and true. We once again do praise and thank you, Lord God, for blessing our souls through all of the songs sung, testimonies, and reading of your word, ushering us into your presence. Dear Lord, my God, we do praise and thank you. Continue, Lord God, to bless us as we get into your word. Continue to minister to our hearts and our minds, Lord God. We will receive whatever that word is for us, that we can take it back home with us as we go, wherever we may be, dear Lord, my God. And continue, Lord Jesus, I pray, to minister to us as only you know how and can. We thank and praise you for this moment in time that you have given to us. Continue to help us, Lord God. I do pray we were weak. We ask you to make us strong in the word and power of your might, that we can continue to living a life that's pleasing unto thee. But that's all you ask us, Lord God. Can you just live a life that's pleasing to me? That's all God asks for. Help us to do this, I pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. As we begin reading this morning, we're going to start in the book of John, chapter 8, and we're going to start at verse 31. And the scriptures have us at a place where Jesus once again is talking to those that, well, they really didn't want to listen or hear, but they were interested in trying to find out who he was. But Jesus is conveying the message to them that if you do not believe in me, there's not going to be any place for you in eternity in my presence. And so once again, in verse 31, God says, and then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. He speaking to the Jews back then, but he's speaking this to us today, because we have the Gentiles have been absorbed into salvation through his precious shed blood. And we're truly, totally grateful for that, Lord God. Verse 32 says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And once again, as Jesus talks, he always talks spiritually. And they always made the mistake of thinking naturally. And they answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and we're never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Well, obviously, these Jews were not really reading the scriptures as they should. I guess they forgot about Egypt, right? When they were slaves. But aside from that, Jesus goes on to say in verse 34, Jesus answered, and verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever. That house is you and I. Our body is a house. But God is saying that the house doesn't stay forever. In other words, that's where we pass away. But the Son abideth forever. Jesus lives forever. He's talking to them because if you don't believe in me, your house is going to go down, but you're going to go into what is called the second death, which they're not even, everything is going over their heads. And he goes on to try to enlighten them by saying, if the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's seed. Ye seek to kill me because my word hath no place in you. If I speak that which I have seen with my father, and ye do that which ye have seen with your father. Now, this is something else that's going over their head. Because they say, they answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. But Jesus goes on to say unto them, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. But now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not Abraham? Ye do the deeds of your father. They said unto him, we be not born of fornication. We have one father, even God. Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, ye would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. I mean, you can't get more exact than that. If God were your father, ye would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. But verse 43 explains, why do ye not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. Ye are of your father, the devil. Now, only Jesus can say something like this, but only Jesus knows the heart of a man internally. Ye are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. And because I tell you the truth, ye believe me not. So Jesus is trying to explain to them, but once again, when you don't want to hear the truth, it goes right over your head, or your heart is so hard, it won't take it in. There was a movie, and some of you might have seen it. It was a movie. It was called A Few Good Men. And it was a movie about two soldiers that are on trial for murdering another soldier. And Tom Cruise was the defense attorney. And he was questioning the head of the base that was in Guantanamo about whether or not he okayed for something called a code red, which is not something that should be done because it means for you to basically assault another officer, I mean, another soldier. And so Tom Cruise is going back and forth with him and getting, of course, heated. And at that particular time, Jack Nicholson was this officer on the being questioned. And he finally said, "You can't handle the truth," to Tom Cruise. Because the truth of the matter is that they have to do things that in, I guess, civilian life, you would not do. And that's what he was saying. You can't handle the truth. For the things that I have to do to protect this country from all of those out there, you can't handle what I have to tell you. And a lot of times Jesus is saying the same thing to us. The things that he's telling us, we can't handle, we can't accept or don't want to accept what he has to say. Jesus confronted and spoke with Pilate about that same issue when he was standing before Pilate. Pilate is asking him, "Are you a king? You know, the people have brought you to me. I'm not a Jew. How do I know if you're a king? And your own people said that brought you to me to crucify you or to condemn you." And he asks him, "Are thou a king?" This is in St. John chapter 18, verse 37. Jesus answered, "Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice." So if you are receiving the word of God, if you are receiving in belief all of what I am telling you, then God is telling you that you are in a place, in a position with your heart, your mind, your soul, your body, and being accepted into his kingdom because you are believing his word. A lot of people can't handle that. They can't handle what it's going to take for you to get there. God, in his infinite grace and mercy, he wrote or had written the Bible, as the scripture says, for our learning, for us to know fully who he is, what God is all about, what he expects from us, and what he is telling us, which is nothing but truth, because the enemy is not going to tell you anything. But, well, let's put it this way. He will mix a truth with a lie. He will never tell you, as they say in the court, and I don't know if they still say this, but do you solemnly swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So help you God. Well, the devil just does part truths, mixed in with more of a lie than anything else. But God will always tell you the unabridged version of nothing but the truth. Revelation chapter 2 starts to explain to us there are seven churches in the Bible that God expresses. These seven churches are, or were, I should say, in a country which is now called Turkey. The seven churches represent the seven ways of churches down through the years or down through time. You notice that these churches have no denomination connected to them. They're just church. But each of these churches represents something that through time, churches have hung on to some of these things. And God wants to reveal to us what some of these things are so that you don't fall into the traps of these churches. Amen. In Revelation chapter 2, he speaks of a church in Ephesus. "Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. And one thing about God is, in these churches, he honors them where honor is due. And he does the same thing to you. When you're doing right, he will tell you that you're doing right. When you're doing wrong, he will tell you that you're doing wrong. Verse 2 says, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars, and hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Now, that's all wonderful. Talking about this church in Ephesus, right? Sound like the church in Ephesus is all right. Verse 4, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Oh my, left their first love. Well, what would that first love be? That first love would be God. Now, how can this church, after God is pretty much telling them how wonderful they are, have left their first love? The Ephesians' deep love and devotion to Christ and his word. This warning teaches us that knowing correct doctrine, obeying some of the commandments, and worshiping in the church are not enough. The church must have above, my notes are all over the place here. And worshiping in the church are not enough. The church must have, above all, a heartfelt love for Jesus Christ and all his word. Sincere love for Christ results in single-hearted devotion to him, purely of life and a love of the truth. Remember I said, the truth will make you free. And the other one is, you can't handle the truth. Depends on what's going on in your life. What is it that you can't handle when God points you out about whatever it is, whatever fault that you might have? Because we all have them. No one is fault free, as I can say. We all have them. So when it's pointed out, it's not to make you worse, but it's to correct whatever it is wrong. God always ministers, he always gives us the opportunity to correct our ways. That's the spirit of God. He tries to bring us out of whatever it is, whatever fault that we're in. And he tries to help us to understand what that is and to correct it again, as I said. But he goes on in verse 6 and he says, but this thou hast that thou hatest. He's giving them another compliment. Thou hatest the deeds of the Nickelodeon, which I also hate. Now, who are these people? Nicolaitans. The Nicolaitans taught that sexual immorality did not affect one's salvation in Christ. The New Testament clearly states the contrary. Such persons shall not inherit the kingdom of God. God hates the doctrine that teaches we can be saved and at the same time live immoral lives. And that's what the church at Ephesus was doing. God, in one of the scriptures, says, can you get from one fountain sweet water and bitter? It's either going to be bitter or it's going to be sweet. So if a church is preaching this in order to satisfy those that are coming to the church, because a lot of times, unfortunately, when people go to church, we're all people, right? We all have shortnesses, faults, and failures. And a lot of times, we don't want to give up that fault, whatever it might be. And if that church is preaching that fault is okay, oh my goodness, then you're fine with that church. It's not making you feel uncomfortable. You need to find a church that tells it like it is so that you can make heaven your home. Because earth is going to pass away. Your life down here is going to pass away. You don't want to be going to a church that God is have some issues with, just because you went to church, as I just mentioned to you in that explanation about Ephesus, it takes more than just going to church. It takes your love for God. That's the key, your love for God. Your love for God will let not just God know who you are, but all of those around you as well. We move on to the next church, the church in Smyrna. Now, the church in Smyrna was not really at much of a fault in their worship of God. Their other situation was they were dirt poor. And you might think, well, if you're dirt poor and you're worshiping God, how? Why are you dirt poor? God has everything. Why is this church dirt poor? But let's listen to what the scripture says in verse 8 of chapter 2. And unto the church, unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. So God is doing an oxymoron here. I mean, you know, the church is, it's materially poor, but it's spiritually rich. Which church would you rather go to? A church that's spiritually rich, that can reach heaven, touch heaven, irregardless of God blessing that church monetarily with members that have bankrolls of money, or that can do wonderful things, have all kinds of programs, but it's all material, it's all earthly. Or would you like, or would you prefer being in a church that can touch heaven? Now, I'm not saying, once again, this church in Smyrna doesn't say what size it is. So size doesn't matter. What matters is your faith and walk with God. That's what matters, because in every church, there's going to be just a small cluster of those that truly love God, because people go to church for any number of reasons. Amen. So even though they in church in Smyrna was dirt poor, God tells them, you are spiritually rich. Because they were spiritually rich, those that love God, which they did, they're going to be spirit, they're going to be going into a place, a heavenly place that goes beyond understanding as far as riches go. So don't count on riches down here. It's the riches that are after this life. That's what really matters. Remember what God says, not to trust in. Don't trust in the riches that come in on an earthly forum, but trust those riches that lead to eternal life. It's just like when God said, what should you strive for first? He said, strive for heaven first. He said, I can give you all that other stuff, but I don't want you to lose your soul because of stuff. So seek me first, and I'll give you the desires of your heart. And you might think, well, a Christian is going to go crazy and want, he or she loves God, and God is going to bless him with like 10 cars, 4 houses, and a boat, and all the rest of this earthly material stuff. Let me tell you something. When you truly love God, none of those things really will matter. They might come your way, but they're not going to matter to you. And not like a person that's in the world, because a person in the world looks at that with pride, what they have. My house is bigger than your house. My car is bigger than your car. You know how that goes, you know, the Joneses. But for a true Christian, they can easily say, you know, really, I don't need that. And that shows where their heart is. That's the reality of truth. It shows you where your heart is. Amen. Yeah, God can give a Christian 5 cars. He can have those 5 cars parked in the garage. Is he going to drive 5 cars? He could drive the 5 cars if he wants to, but if God was to ask him to give it all up, that would be the first thing that person would do. Because it's material. Anything, even when you buy the most expensive, whatever, brand new, it's going to break down. It's going to go into some kind of disrepair, because that's earthly stuff. Heavenly stuff lasts, well, forever. And that's the truth that God's trying to put into our hearts and minds, what to strive for, those things that lead to eternal life. He set on record these churches so that these churches and us will understand what to stay away from. Amen. If you found a church that's preaching the true word of God and has a love of God in the house, then that's a wonderful place to be. Because once again, God's word is what really matters. Nothing that goes on in a church really matters other than the love of God. Because that's why you're supposed to be going there anyhow. We make up as we go along with church, why we go to that church. I went to a church growing up from childhood, right across the street from where I live. And it had programs. I was in the Cub Scouts. My sister was in the Brownies. They had a, what they call a June festival every year, where they had, they could parade down the streets in Jamaica. It was wonderful. They had clubs, they had this, they had that, they had the other thing. But when I became of a certain age, none of that stuff mattered. I needed more. I needed, what I needed was Jesus. I needed Jesus in my heart in a deeper way. Because the church, unfortunately, also with all of the, they also went to Atlantic City. I mean, they also had musical events. We're not talking Christian here, we're talking about jazz. All of these different things are hanger-on things from the world. But you see, when the heart of a man compromises with the world, it weakens God's word. They're in a weakened state. They're in a state where, once again, they can, they're compromising their faith with how they should walk with God. And they say, it's okay. Well, guess what? It is not okay. You're going to risk your soul on being in a church that's so-so. Again, it's your soul. It's up to you. God is giving us his word to try to help us out this morning in these seven churches. And I'm moving right along here because Church of Pergamos. And the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he that hath the sharp sword with two edges. I know thy works, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days when Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. Now that reference to Satan's seat, basically is just a certain area in this city of Pergamos where it was more Satan and satanic driven than in other parts of Pergamos. He goes on to say, but in verse 14, but I have a few things against thee because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam. Now, who is Balaam? Well, Balaam was a false prophet who sold his services to a heathen king and counseled him to tempt Israel to engage in immorality. The doctrine of Balaam refers to corrupt teachers and preachers who were leading their people into fatal compromise with immorality, worldliness, and false ideologies, all for the sake of personal advancement or monetary gain. The church at Pergamos had teachers who taught the saving faith in Christ and a lifestyle if immorality were compatible. Now, how do you justify that? How do you possibly justify that? Well, it's justified when that's what you want to do. If you want to do something, it's easy to justify. And that's what the church in Pergamos was doing. But God was alerting them that this is not something that he's pleased with. And that's the same thing with us. He told them where he was pleased with them, but also where he was distressed because of what they were doing. Now, whether or not they made the souls of the people that went to this church in Pergamos found the right way or not, the Bible doesn't tell us that, but it does tell us what that church was like at that particular time. He goes on to say in verse 16, repent or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the word of my mouth, sword of my mouth. And he said, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth save he that receiveth it. That's salvation. Salvation is what God is talking about. If you overcome, if your eyes get opened to see really where you are and what you're doing, what you have surrounded yourself with, what you have compromised yourself with, God is asking you, is this what you want? This is not pleasing to me, but is this really what you want? The church in Thyatira, he says, and unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess. Now, you know, from the Bible, I have never heard, now maybe somebody's out there named Jezebel, but I have never heard of someone naming their daughter Jezebel. I sure hope not. Its reference mainly is because of the Jezebel in the Old Testament and what she was about and what she did. And God wants us to understand that the church in Thyatira had a tendency to tolerate sin and unrighteousness or unbiblical teaching in its leaders. That's what was happening in the church in Thyatira. And that was not going to fly in the sight of God. And he's warning them. But I say unto you, verse 24, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depth of Satan, as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden, if you repent. But that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. For those that have repented, hold fast, there'll be a lot against you, but hold fast. There'll be a lot of pressure against you, but hold fast. Because he's displeased with certain aspects of the church. When you have a tendency to tolerate sin. Now, I know that much is made of the situation of homosexuality. And I want to tell you that homosexuality is a sin against God. The Bible makes it plain. Can't get any plainer. It's not my Bible, it's God's Bible. He says it's wrong, it's wrong. It's the truth, right? If a homosexual comes into the church looking for God, you don't cast them out. You pray for that person. We're in a position of praying for people, not casting them out, not throwing. Satan wants to throw out God's creation, not, you shouldn't be the Christian. The thing is that that person has to understand that God will not tolerate that lifestyle. That's what they have to, whether they stay or not, they have to understand that God will not tolerate that lifestyle. If they continue in that lifestyle after they've heard the truth, then that's on them. Their soul is in trouble and destined for hell. Whether they want to accept it or not, that's not on you, that's not on me, that's on them. Because no one's in the closet anymore. The closet is wide open. But the Bible says men with men, women with women is an abomination to God. It's simple. Now that's a truth that we in the church also need to understand, not to tolerate, whether it be that immoral behavior, whether it be the immoral behavior of adultery, fornication, whether it be drinking, any form of anything that goes against God's word. Look, we have to stop patty caking people. We have to tell it like it is, in love now. So that their soul, it's all about the soul, that their soul not be lost. You're concerned about the person's soul more than they are. But a lot of times they have no power to overcome the wickedness that now dwells on the inside. That's what you have to understand when they start fighting against you. It's that demon, that demonic spirit. It's not really them. If you could see them as a person, they're like a little person with inside of themselves screaming for help. But now they have no power. They have no voice because they gave it over to the enemy a long time ago. And the enemy is powerful. He's not going to just leave. He's going to fight you tooth and nail. So that's why, once again, it takes a lot of prayer. Doesn't mean that God cannot deliver. God is a deliverer. God is the deliverer. He delivered my dad from alcoholism, so I know he's a deliverer. We know he delivers us from disease, from sickness. It's to show his glory and his power to his humanity. But we have to understand the part that we are to play. Don't compromise with the world. Don't say it's okay. It's not okay. Plain and simple, it's not okay. Don't start having people in officiating business in the church and they got issues still going on. I mean, and unfortunately, a lot of churches compromise and do that. People still combating alcoholism and they got them playing the piano in the church. I mean, the church cannot compromise where they want certain positions filled and certain talents come in the church, but yet they're not saved talents. They're worldly talents at this point. And because of that, we accept them almost to stay as they are, just don't make any waves. But wait a minute. It's their soul that you're supposed to be praying for. It's their soul that's in trouble. Forget the piano. Forget the choir. Their soul's in trouble. And if they want to leave because you're actually pretty much putting them on the line by telling them the truth, you're telling them the truth that they leave, you still pray for them. But don't compromise because you need a piano player, because you need a drummer, because they have a very beautiful voice and we need singers. But that's what the church in Thyatira was doing. They were compromising for various reasons. And God is saying, I'm coming to my house first. When he says his house, he's saying the church. When I'm coming to my house first. And I'm doing a clean sweep of those not doing the right thing, professing godliness, but living a life totally contrary to his word. The only church that, let me get into Sardis. And we're moving right along here. I'm almost done. This is chapter 3, verse 1. Of Revelation. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard. Why is God speaking like this? It's because the church in Sardis was spiritually dead. It still had a building. They still had services. People still sang. People still played. But spiritually, they were dead. Sometimes people go to church for so long that it just becomes the thing to do. There's no more spirit involved. It's just, it's Sunday. It's 10 o'clock. It's time to go to church. But spiritually, it means nothing at all to them. Grandparents got their name written on a pew. Somebody donated money, and that stained glass belongs to them. And that's material stuff. Who cares about the pew? Who cares about the stained glass, for Pete's sakes? It's about the soul. So Sardis was in trouble because they became dead. The only way to enliven that church is through repenting and turning your face to the wall, that church, that whole church. And it would have to start with the leadership and asking God to forgive them and turn from their wicked ways, reinvigorate themselves. And sometimes that comes from having certain services in order to revive people. But once again, that reviving comes from you as an individual with your own personal walk with God. Church in Philadelphia, God had nothing bad to say. Nothing at all bad to say about the church in Philadelphia. Verse 7, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the king, the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth, and shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set because their works please God. What did he do? I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. Thou hast a little strength and has kept my word and has not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, those that war against you, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet and to know that I have loved thee. That's the church of Philadelphia. When you get it right before God, an open door, my Lord, an open door for you to walk in because of you pleasing God. The last church, verse 14 of chapter 3, and unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. My Lord, the whole church was just a lukewarm, no fire. That's just as bad as leaving their first love. All form and fashion, and even the form and fashion, was mediocre. God said, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. You're wasting your time coming to this place you call my house, because your devotion, your service, your love for me is weak. It's non-existent. It's not even weak. It's non-existent. I'm going to spew you out of my mouth, because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods. And this is a church that looks good. Got stained glass all over the place. And that's the false reading of a church that looks like it's successful, because it looks successful. And have no need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine head's eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. So in all of these churches, God sends out a signal to us today to help us to be aware of such things, so that we don't become, whether it be mediocre, whether we lost our first love in Christ, or whether we are carrying too many things of the world into the church, are we at a place where, once again, we think that immoral behavior and walking with God are compatible, or whether it be our thoughts or our attitude or the deeds that we do. God is saying, I'm warning you, but God is gracious. He says, if you will repent, I will forgive you. So in other words, come back to me. Come back to a true relationship with me. If you fall into the category of any of these churches that were at fault, if you are one of those in a church in Philadelphia, bless your soul. Because it's hard to find a blessed, good church Just like it's hard to find a good mechanic, a good doctor, it's hard to find a good church, one that truly loves God. Because the devil is on the job weakening God's house as much as possible. So stay strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Lean not to your own understanding with things, but trust in the Lord. Amen. God bless your souls. Believe it or not, we are in our first Sunday in March, and first Sunday means we are going to have communion. We're going to start by reading the scripture in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I'm not going to apologize for being long today. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starting at the 23rd verse. I'm going to read the scripture first, then I'm going to come back, and that's when we're going to partake of the Lord's body and his blood. For I have received, this is 1 Corinthians chapter 11, once again, verse 23. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. That the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest will I set in order when I come. Verse 24. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. And please forgive me.
You're muted, Pastor.
Please forgive me. I forgot to have prayer before taking the sacrament this morning. But all things being with you, we're going to move on. And right now we're going to have a closing prayer for the service. We're going to have our Uncle Roy, Elder Roy Stewart, after after the prayer list plays, I'm going to have our Elder Roy Stewart close us out in prayer. Amen.
First Lady, you're muted.
Bye.
Amen. Elder Roy Stewart, would you please close us out this afternoon?
Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, in the name of Jesus, yes. You are our God, you are our Savior, you are our deliverer.
Yes, Lord.
And Lord, we worship you this yes. day. We look to you, Lord, the giver of life, the sustainer of life. Lord, we look to you for our strength and courage to go day by day, moment by moment, Lord, knowing that you will supply our every need. And Lord, we thank you for the word that was given to us today by Pastor John. Concerning the seven churches, Lord, mentioned in the book of Revelation.
Yes.
And we thank you, Lord, for him making us aware of the different churches and the different things that they found themselves lacking. Even though they may have looked good from the outside, but Lord, you told them their shortcomings. Let us find ourselves, Lord, since we are the church. Help us, Lord, to see ourselves in the light that you have painted, Lord, this picture that you've painted of the churches. And let us, Lord, seek to be like the Church of Philadelphia, one that's pleasing, one that you can be proud of, and one that you can look to as an example of how the church should be. Help us, Lord, in all of our ways to be pleasing to you. And now as we close out the service today, Lord, in this benediction,
yes.
go with us this week, Lord. We understand that the horse is prepared against the day of battle. The safety is of you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Keep us safe from hurt, harm, and danger. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
God bless everyone.
Amen.
Coming. Thank you, Elder Roy Stewart, for that powerful yet moving prayer. God bless
Amen.
You. God bless you. Everyone can.